After learning about the British American colonies and the Revolutionary period, we have to study how the United States came to take the form that we know of today. We have the Constitution of the United States, but what many people don't realize is that this was actually a replacement for the original form of government that was much less functional. The Articles of Confederation were the form of government that the United States undertook after the end of hostilities in the Revolutionary War. The Treaty of Paris didn't formally end the war until 1783, but the Battle of Yorktown, as you know, ended all of the fighting in 1781. And so for a 7-year period, the Articles of Confederation were in use until there was a constitutional convention called to replace it. So one of the main reasons that the Articles is so dysfunctional is that there were hardly any powers that had actually been granted to the government. They could declare war if necessary. They could manage foreign affairs, trade agreements, etc. And they could make treaties with other governments. But there was very little they could do within the United States itself. And many proposals were made in the 7-year window of time that the articles existed to make the national government a lot stronger, but none of them are approved because without unanimous support from the states, you can't get a whole lot done. One of the few successes of the articles were the land ordinances, particularly the Northwest Ordinance. And it really was an organization of how the territories that had yet to become states, they were unorganized territories, what kind of population thresholds would be necessary before they would reach statehood, also what the organization of counties within those states would look like, etc. So this was one success of the Articles of Confederation. The biggest weakness of the Articles was that there was no power to tax. And with no power to tax, you could do hardly anything because you need tax revenues to pay for almost anything that the government needs to do, like paying off debts that had been procured from foreign governments during the Revolutionary War. Veterans from the war couldn't receive their benefits, payments after the fact. And existing military officials and soldiers can't be paid. So it's really one of the biggest reasons for dysfunction. And it is this lack of ability to pay veterans and existing military officials that leads to one of the scariest moments in the early Republic, and that is that veterans started to get really angry with the government, and it even led to an event known as Shays' Rebellion. This was in Massachusetts. There's farmers that were in debt and they wanted some of their payments from the government, but without any tax revenue, the government couldn't give them the money. They needed it to keep their farms. Their farms were at risk of being foreclosed on. Daniel Shays was a hero of the Revolutionary War, and he stepped up and actually led a rebellion that shut down the state's court system that would prevent any foreclosures from continuing. This rebellion had to be put down by an army raised by the governor, and it was barely put down. It was very shocking how this ragtag group of veterans could nearly overthrow the government of Massachusetts, and it led to a debate over the entire Articles of Confederation. Pretty soon, there were calls for a convention to draft changes to the government. Now, this was not meant originally to be wholesale change that we know ended up happening, but the Philadelphia Convention was convened in the summer of 1787. Here is the only known depiction of Daniel Shays, a painting of him. And there are some contrasting views on this incident. Thomas Jefferson is quoted as having said, "A little rebellion now and then is a good thing. The tree of liberty must be refreshed from time to time with the blood of patriots and tyrants," meaning that the government needed to have a fear of its citizens. And so he actually thought that things like Shays' Rebellion were a good thing. James Madison, on the other hand, said, "Liberty may be endangered by the abuses of liberty as well as the abuses of power." And what he meant, really, was that unchecked public liberty might actually threaten private liberties like property ownership by overthrowing the government and causing chaos. So if there's chaos and anarchy, that's not good for anybody either. So who was at the convention and what were their beliefs? Well, one of the most vocal nationalists to attend the convention was Alexander Hamilton. He thought that a strong national government would promote American power, particularly economic growth. And this is going to be important. We're going to reference back to this when we talk about Alexander Hamilton serving as President Washington's Secretary of the Treasury. Now, a much more pragmatic man, not nearly as aggressive as Alexander Hamilton, was James Madison. He feared that unchecked personal liberty might lead to anarchy and ultimately lead to loss of liberty. So he knew that there needed to be a stronger national government, but he wasn't quite as hardcore nationalist as Alexander Hamilton was. So who was in attendance? Obviously, Hamilton and Madison were in attendance. Thomas Jefferson and John Adams were not. And they were pretty significant figures in this time period. Both of them were diplomats. Jefferson had gone to France, Adams to Britain, so they were not present for the Philadelphia Convention. Nearly all those who do attend are upper-class wealthy people. You do not see very many lower-class citizens. More than half of the attendees had college educations. And to put this in perspective for you, less than 1% of the U.S. population in 1787 had college degrees. So this is the elite of the elite of society drafting the Constitution. The hearings were held in secret so that the debates could be open and honest without fear of newspaper articles getting put out there and public scrutiny coming back on them before they had even concluded the proceedings. The only modern record of the Philadelphia Convention that we have are the careful notes that were taken by James Madison, which were sorted through and published for public viewing after his death in 1836. So for quite a long period of time, nobody really knew what had gone on at the convention, and it wasn't until Madison's belongings had been gone through before people did know. Here is a famous painting of the convention, and there's a couple of things that are a little inaccurate here. First of all, you wouldn't have all of these gentlemen quite as nicely dressed. They would, in circumstances of a meeting, remove their coats, for example, especially because they were meeting in the summer of 1787. The summer of 1787 was actually record heat. So we know summertime is hot to begin with. It was actually record heat. Obviously, there's no such thing as fans or air conditioning in this time period, so it would have been pretty hot and miserable, and you probably wouldn't see quite the formal dress that is in this painting. Now, once they start debating the issues, they realize they need to convince the people that the Constitution is of the people and not elites. They knew that being elite themselves, people may be suspicious of them. So the preamble, the introduction, shall we say, to the Constitution starts, "We the people of the United States." And it's to show unified support for this stronger federal government, and that the power of the government stemmed from the consent of the governed. Remember the Enlightenment thinkers that we discussed, the wording of the Declaration of Independence by Thomas Jefferson, using those Enlightenment thinkers' thoughts. So the preamble is meant to attract people's attention to the fact that this is a document of the people and not of just the elites. So the biggest debates were had over how the government would be structured. It was easy to say, let's have a separation of powers, let's have three branches of government. The more difficult piece is checks and balances, which leads me to go over these terms very carefully. People often confuse separation of powers and checks and balances as meaning the same thing. They are not, so let me go over it again. The ability to divide your government into three branches is relatively easy to say. Let's have three branches of government. But it is very carefully giving each of those three branches very particular powers to maintain a fair balance of power that creates checks and balances. So separation of powers and checks and balances are indeed two very different things. One of the hottest debates had was over the legislative branch. And the intention for the legislature to be divided into two houses known as bicameral was explained to the delegates. Now, bi and una are Greek and Latin roots, and cameral sounds kind of like camel. So if you think about it, camels that have one or two humps, bi, una, bicycle and unicycle, well, bicameral, to remember the term, you think of a two-humped camel. Now, I know that's goofy and silly, but I guarantee you will now remember the terms bicameral and unicameral because of one and two-humped camels. So, not only does the bicameral legislature get laid out, but it specifically forms into what we now know to be the House of Representatives and the Senate. To get there, you first had to have suggested plans. Now, it was the brainchild of James Madison, but Governor Edmund Randolph of Virginia was the one to propose the Virginia Plan. And he proposed that representation in the bicameral legislature would be based on population, and that slaves should count as part of your population. Naturally, smaller states were not going to be big fans of this plan. It was going to allow Virginia, that at the time was hands down the largest state in the country, to dominate politics. The New Jersey plan was thrown out by William Paterson of New Jersey, and this proposed that yes, there would be a bicameral legislature, but that representation should be equal for all states. And furthermore, slaves could not count as part of your population because they're not citizens. Now, obviously, that's a moot point because they wanted equal representation in both houses of the Congress anyway, but they wanted to point out that Virginia was hands down trying to exert their authority over the entire nation by this Virginia plan. Things broke down. There was a back and forth of arguing at the convention, and it nearly fell apart with no outcome. But another idea of James Madison was the Great Compromise. He knows, however, that being from Virginia, people are going to be very wary of him. They're going to wonder, is he just trying to manipulate us? So he goes to another delegate from Connecticut, a man named Roger Sherman, and says, I think I have an idea, but I want you to be the one to propose it. It will be taken more seriously. So the Connecticut Compromise, better known as the Great Compromise, suggested that in the bicameral legislature, you would simply have one of each type of representation. In one house of the Congress, you would have proportional representation, so based on population. And the other house of Congress, you would have equal representation. And both of these houses of Congress would have to approve a bill before the president, we'll get to that later, the executive branch, to become law. Later, we're going to learn the process how a bill becomes a law. So, after all this heated debate, we now today have the House of Representatives, which uses proportional representation, which means it is based entirely on population. To serve in this House, you have to be a minimum of 25 years old, a minimum of 7 years as a citizen of the United States. It's a 2-year term of office, and it is the House that owns the power to impeach officials. It's probably its biggest power. Your Central New York 24th Congressional District Representative is a man by the name of John Katko. He has been serving since 2015. He replaced Dan Maffei, who actually served 2 different 2-year terms from 2009 to 11, and then again from 2013 to 15. A woman by the name of Anne Marie Berkel, who served in between Dan Maffei's 2 different terms, and James Walsh, who served from 1989 to 2009. The other house of the legislature is a 100-member Senate because each state has 2 senators. So the original Senate had many fewer. Today we have 100 because we have 50 states. To serve in the Senate, you had to be a minimum of 35 years old, a minimum of 9 years as a citizen. It's a 6-year term of office. It tries any impeached official with the Supreme Court Chief Justice presiding over the proceedings. So if the House of Representatives votes to impeach someone, the trial happens in the Senate. It is based on equal representation, as I pointed out before, and the vice president leads the Senate and breaks any tie votes. And it has happened numerous times that there are tie votes that have to be broken by the vice president. So that's the basic structure of our Congress today. And it was created after many, many heated debates in the Constitutional Convention. Debates that nearly brought it to an end without a finished product, as I pointed out before. Your 2 New York state senators are a man by the name of Charles Schumer and a woman by the name of Kirsten Gillibrand. Both of them have been serving multiple terms. A reignited debate after the Great Compromise created the bicameral legislature with one of each type of representation is, are slaves going to count towards population? Because William Patterson didn't want them to count. Edmund Randolph did. So they had to reach some kind of compromise, and they decided that slaves would count as three-fifths of a person in deciding representation. They also decided that there would be no law outlawing the international slave trade for 20 years. So a date of 1808 was set. And lastly, that no slave tax could exceed $10. Now, this should really show you just how less than human the founders thought slaves to be, particularly the Southern delegates. There were Northern delegates that said allowing slavery at all in this new constitution would be a stain on it for all time. We now know that to be true. But Southern delegates refused to even entertain a conversation about eliminating slavery. And it just showed that even Northerners who didn't agree with slavery were willing to compromise on the value of a human being by creating a situation where only 3 out of every 5 slaves would count towards the population of a state when deciding the number of congressional districts that they would have, and therefore number of representatives in the House. Other compromises were necessary over trade. If you remember, one of the other reasons that the Articles of Confederation were dysfunctional was not only the lack of a power to tax, but the dysfunction of different states having different currencies and different states having different trade rules and laws and having trade wars with each other. Today, there are nations around the world that have trade wars with each other. There were trade wars happening between states under the Articles. A lot of that dysfunction needed to be sorted out. So one thing was Northern manufacturing states wanted taxes on imports to make sure that foreign goods would be more expensive and people would be more attracted to buying American goods. Southern agricultural states opposed any taxes on exports because of how much money they made off of their cash crops, like tobacco and cotton. So the decision was very easy. Taxes would be allowed on imports. That is referred to as a tariff. It's a very specific kind of tax on imports, but not on exports. Article 2 describes the executive branch. You'll notice it took us a long time just now to discuss Article 1, and if you look at the body of the Constitution, the longest section of it is Article 1. And that is because it was seen by the founders as the most crucial part of the Constitution to make sure that you got the legislature right. But as they moved into Article 2, you had a decision on what the executive branch would look like. First of all, it would be one person. There had been some discussion of a possible committee of people, but they decided that with some of the decisive decisions that would need to be made, that it needed to be an individual. Some of the requirements. One, you had to be a natural-born citizen. You could not be an immigrant. You had to be a minimum of 35 years old. Service is a 4-year term. When there's a vacancy on the Supreme Court, it is appointed by the president with approval from the Senate. They hold very specific roles, such as chief executive or the face of the government, the leader of the government. The chief diplomat, the only one allowed to negotiate with foreign leaders. And if someone else negotiates on your behalf, you are the only one that are allowed to sign and codify something into a treaty, which again would require the approval of the Senate. There are some of your checks and balances at work. And lastly, commander-in-chief, probably the most well-known. The president is in charge of the military. So presidential powers are offset by legislative and judicial powers. We'll get to the judicial branch in a moment. And all of these checks and balances were put into place very intentionally by the founders. So Article 3, the judicial branch, the Supreme Court and the lower courts. There were no specifications as to the number of justices or the qualifications for how you would become one. The very first court had 6 justices. Today, there are 9 justices. One of the biggest reasons for the change is because with 6 justices, there were tie votes. With an odd number, you prevent tie votes. Their biggest power is the ability to declare laws or actions of government unconstitutional. So what that means is if a state government or maybe even the federal government tried to pass a law and it was not within the powers given in the Constitution to the government, then the Supreme Court can vote to overturn and declare unconstitutional that law. You see our current Supreme Court, we've had 2 recent deaths and 1 recent retirement on the Supreme Court. And if you follow along with me, starting with the top row on the left-hand side, you have Justice Brett Kavanaugh, who was appointed in 2018, Elena Kagan, who was appointed in 2010, Neil Gorsuch, who was appointed in 2017, Amy Coney Barrett, who was appointed in 2020, and now I'm shifting to the bottom row. All the way to the left, you have Samuel Alito, who was appointed in 2005, Clarence Thomas, appointed in 1991, John Roberts, who is the Chief Justice of the court, who was appointed in 2005, Stephen Breyer, who was appointed in 1994, and Sonia Sotomayor, appointed in 2009. So that is the current makeup as of 2021 of the United States Supreme Court. Article 4 deals with interstate relations. And Section 1 deals with the fact that states have to share documents and resources with each other when necessary. So you have a driver's license and you drive across state lines, you're not all of a sudden driving illegally. And this is very similar to the concept of different states having different currencies and different trade regulations and rules. If you don't honor each other's documents and resources, it's going to be a very dysfunctional system, just like the Articles of Confederation. Section 2, Part 1, a citizen's rights do not change when they cross state lines. Part 2, criminals are not free if they manage to escape to another state. If you're a criminal in one state, you're going to be a criminal in another state. And as a matter of fact, if you're caught in that other state, they will send you back for your trial in the previous state that you left. Part 3, very controversial. We will return to this in future discussions in this course. Slaves are not free just because they escape to another state. Section 3 laid out the protocol for territories becoming states, modeled very much after the Northwest Ordinance, the only real success of the Articles. And Section 4, the U.S. federal government will always protect states against invasion and/or domestic violence. What this sounds like is something easy peasy. Yeah, we'll have a military, it'll protect everybody, great. Well, under the Articles, states had their own militias. There really wasn't much of a military to be spoken of at the time, and what this was guaranteeing, protection for all states, would make it much less necessary for states to spend their funds on militias, or exorbitant amounts of funds anyway, on militias, if the federal government was going to provide that kind of protection. Article 5 outlines the amendment process. The founders knew that they were not perfect. They included the amendment process to allow for change over time. And the only way to add an amendment to the Constitution today is to have a two-thirds majority vote in both the House and the Senate. After those two-thirds majority votes are both had, three-quarters of all state legislatures must approve it. The first 10 amendments to the U.S. Constitution come to be known as the Bill of Rights, and we're going to learn about all of that in great detail in the next lesson. And in the lesson after that, as a matter of fact, while we discuss the ratification debates, because the Bill of Rights was kind of a carrot and the stick approach to get some of the people who were not supportive of the Constitution to support it. There are miscellaneous provisions included as well, like all debts owed by the Confederation remain the same. We're not going to renege on all of our debts. Section 2, any situation where a state law conflicts with a federal law, the federal government is to be considered supreme, supremacy clause. Section 3, all public officials will take an oath of office but cannot have their religious beliefs work in their favor, nor can they be used against them. And Article 7 outlined ratification. 9 of the 13 states must approve of the Constitution for it to pass. The convention released the Constitution to the public for consideration on September 17th of 1787. Now you may ask, well, how long did it take them to ratify the Constitution? 9 states had ratified the Constitution by June of 1788, initiating it as the new U.S. government. All 13 original states had ratified the Constitution by May of 1790. The threshold was reached as soon as New Hampshire voted in favor of the Constitution on June 21st of 1788. So this is the convention, how it shaped our government. We're going to get into a lot more detail on some of these things. This was really an overview when we go through the three branches of government piece by piece and in a lot more detail. We will expand upon some of what you've already heard, add some things that you haven't yet heard, and if there are any questions based on this brief overview, by all means, reach out to me. Otherwise, I'll see you in class.